So in the beginning, there was Rainworld, and then God said, let there be DLC.
This expansion has been more than great, despite the fact that I got spoiled for one of the endings on my own YouTube channel by three different people. That being said, this video is going to be the opposite of spoiler-free. It will be a spoiler-intensive review of all the new Downpour content, covering each campaign, Safari Mode, Expedition, and the challenges. If you want to see my thoughts on any particular bits, use the chapters or timestamps. Anyways, let's talk about some odds and ends. Regardless of if you bought Downpour or not, you get access to Remix, which is a free update that includes native mod support, as well as new options that help temper some issues that are infamous for making the game not very fun, including a reindeer fix that works sometimes. It also offers in-game assists and accessibility options, which I am a huge fan of. They range from quality of life, like a visual breath indicator, to just straight up letting you remove karma requirements from the game entirely. It's very nice that Video Cult put out these changes for free, because some of them fix issues that were detrimental to a lot of people's enjoyment of the game, so well done.
Next, I'd like to take a brief look at the newly included Safari mode. Safari allows you to see the Rainworld ecosystem at work. In addition, it allows you to revoke their god-given autonomy and control them for yourself.
This mode is silly, fun, and harmless, but ultimately it's pretty pointless. It's interesting to watch how different things interact with each other without the threat of being murdered to death,
but there's only really so much mileage I can get out of role-playing kelp.
There's no goals or even anything that you can do. I tried to bring an egg bug to the void and the game crashed. Egg bugs are not worthy of ascension.
I also managed to take an eel lizard to Looks to the Moon and bit her several times where she did not react. I can only assume that she goes through this quite often.
I would love to talk more about Safari mode, but that really is it. There's nothing else to it. Control a hive mind of leeches. Clip out of the map as a lizard. Moving on.
Piggybacking off of Safari mode, I would be remiss if I did not at least talk about some of the new creatures that were introduced. Honestly, not a huge fan. While not a lot of them actively harm Downpour's experience, a lot of them don't really add anything. A lot of the creatures that were added are just creatures that already exist, but with little tweaks added to them. Caramel, eel, and strawberry lizards are just lizards. Jungle leeches are just leeches. Aquapedes are just bigger and reskinned centawings. Mother longlegs is just a really, really big daddy longlegs. Elite scavengers are just scavengers that can yump. Mother spiders are just spiders that explode into more spiders. And fire bugs are just fucked up egg bugs. Giant jellyfish and inspectors are unique, but they don't really add a lot. Giant jellyfish just kinda sit there as a stationary obstacle, and inspectors you only really encounter in two places in the game. This results in the funniest sentence ever, being that I believe that the best new creature that was added to Downpour are yeeks. Yes, I'm serious. They are the best completely unique creatures that this campaign has added. The creatures are a lot of what makes this game what it is. It's a nature simulator. You're out in the wild, fighting against other animals for survival. So it's only natural that Downpour would introduce a lot of new creatures. But like I said, a lot of these aren't really new, they're just reskins of other things. Stowaways are technically unique, but I mean, they're just kind of like advanced dropwigs that aren't even active all of the time. I've been kicking around some communities recently, and a lot of the people have only just found stowaways, like, within the past month. It's May. And like I said, none of these creatures are detrimental to the game. They do add stuff, it's just not interesting or very new. And, oh, well, if you insist, I'll talk about Miros vultures. You took a Miros bird, you took a vulture, and you made Satan. You not only Frankenstein two creatures together that people already fucking despise, you make it able to crawl through one tile wide pipes, and then you give it an explosion attack. Why? And that's not even the worst part about Miros vultures, because their behavior is bugged out. They are overwhelmingly aggressive towards the player, and will hunt you down almost exclusively. And if you've played Downpour, you've probably noticed that if you run into a Miros vulture, it never seems to fuck off. That's because the percentage values that normally dictate whether it's gonna give up on you and do something else are extremely inflated. And no, this is not intended behavior. This is confirmed to be a bug. This is not how they're supposed to act at all, and it just makes me fucking hate them more. There are a random mishmash of two creatures that are already kind of annoying to deal with, and it's glitched out and it doesn't make sense, and I really, really do not like them. Remember how I said most of the new creatures are, like, they're not that good, but they don't actively harm the playing experience? Miros Vultures are the exception to that. They actively make my experience playing this game worse. They also have 20 hit points. This is more than a regular Miros Bird and a King Vulture combined. I would like to unsubscribe from this, please.
Up next is Expedition, which is a game mode kind of meant to increase the longevity of the game. The way it does this is by offering different quests that you can do to earn points and unlock things. You can randomize these challenges all at once or individually. You can also manually filter out tasks that you'd rather not do, so the game stops telling you to do spear pinning as Saint. Thanks. There's also an option to make one or more of the challenges hidden, which gives you double the points you would normally get, but you can't see what the hidden challenges are until you've completed all of the non-hidden ones. I would only really use this if you're committed to the expedition, because the first time I tried to do this, it gave me the Pilgrim achievement, which kind of fucked with my vibes a little. After you decide what challenges you'd like to do, it will spawn you in a random shelter of whatever Slugcat that you chose in their points in the timeline. If you're just starting out, you'll notice that you cannot find Karma Flowers, nor can you use passages that you've obtained. Expedition also introduces a permadeath mechanic, where if you die at bottom Karma without a Karma Flower, it will mark the expedition as failed and you will either have to retry it from the beginning or abandon it altogether.
As you level up in expeditions, you'll unlock several things, the most notable of are perks and burdens. Perks are special boosts that you can apply to the start of any individual expedition and grant you special items or abilities, such as being able to use passages, start with a Karma Flower, or give any Slugcat the abilities of another. Spearmaster with Artificer's Explosive Jump and Hunter's Backspear is a thing of beauty.
My personal favorite thing that you can unlock is Burden. These grant you a percent bonus to the points you earn during the expedition and have severe drawbacks based on which ones you pick. I do want to go over each one in a little bit of detail.
Blinded, which makes the entire world Shaded Citadel. Gross. Doomed, which makes it so that you lose the expedition if you die at all without having a Karma Flower. Hunted, which makes every enemy in a region know the exact room you're in. God help you if you spawn in Subterranean. But all of these pale in comparison to Pursued. Now, let's take a gander at this description. Something stalks you through the world, endlessly searching for its target. Though not impossible to defeat, it will always return.
Now, that sounds really cool, right? Well, what it actually does is it spawns a funny centipede that you're not even guaranteed to run into, and if you do, you can just pipe juke it until you lose it. That's it. That's the burden.
I put the Pursued Burden on almost all of my expeditions after I unlocked it, and I think I died to it about 3 times in total. Also, when it dies, this happens. Yeah! In addition to perks and burdens, you can also unlock songs from the game's soundtrack, which is useful for if you don't use Spotify or other music streaming services. But since I do, it's just kind of a collector's thing. You can, however, set Random Gods to be your main menu theme, which is really, really good.
And speaking of music, I would like to take this opportunity to go on one of many long detours that this video is going to go on, and talk a little bit about this game's soundtrack. Without a doubt, this game's soundtrack is absolutely beautiful, not only Downpours, but Rainworlds in general. I have not listened to another video game soundtrack as much as I have the Rainworld and Downpour ones. There are so many ones that I could highlight and talk about, but a couple that stick out to me are Sheer Ice Torrent, Veiled North Star, Chilblain Grace, Orange Lizard, and honestly, every single one of the new threat themes is very, very good. I'd say my favorite is probably the unused Rubicon threat. Though my personal favorites are Rain, Scapeless Doubt, and Trusted Component, which I'm playing right now. The thing that makes this soundtrack so good and so
re-listenable is that it covers so many different genres and styles of music. A lot of it is instrumental, a lot of it is experimental, there's some electronica in there, there's a lot of synthesizers, and it even dips into rock with some songs like Orange Lizard. Two other games that I play that I think have absolutely wonderful soundtracks are Night in the Woods and Buddy Simulator 1984, which play Buddy Simulator 1984, just trust me on that. But these games feature beautiful music that draws out a lot of emotion. And I've thrashed them with how much I've listened to the Downpour OST, and it's only April. In addition to adding a bunch of wonderful music, they also brought back a lot of unused tracks from the game's original soundtrack. The two notable examples I can think of right now are Halcyon Memories, which is misspelled, okay, and Reclaiming Entropy, which is known as Theme 4 Credits in the Alpha Gems and Junk album. Moving on from that, it's time to talk about challenges. I like the arena mode. It's always had a lot of potential, but it's always felt aimless and never really amounted to more than anything than just something to let you goof around a bit.
I mean, you can spawn 50 Leviathans in a tiny enclosed space, but then what? So, there are 70 challenges that are mostly creative, and mostly not terrible. Mostly. Contrary to what you might expect, a lot of the challenges don't actually involve combat. Instead, it's heavily varied with goals involving needing to hide from enemies, eat food, survive a certain amount of time, or my personal favorite, babysitting. The world's worst babysitting. It requires you to keep 8 slug pups alive for 2.5 minutes without any of them dying. Some other fun ones are hard-boiled, where you need to load the newly introduced joke rifle with noodle fly eggs, shoot the babies out, and eat 12 points of them without being killed by the mother. Stygian Depths, which requires you to gain 100 points as Saint. This can be accomplished by ascending a firebug and using its eggs to blow up other creatures. I like this one because it uses the otherwise unused Rubicon threat music, and, fun fact, Rubicon was originally going to be called Stygian Depths. Toxic Distillery, which is literally just a speedrun challenge with Rivulet and the Orb, and Daddy World, which is a challenge that actually sucks ass, but it has a funny name. Speaking of ass, some challenges I think should die and then die again are
Target Practice, which requires you to pop 5 popcorn plants without hitting a squid kata, and they're angry at you and hate you because you suck.
Armor-piercing rounds, which introduces an actually unkillable red centipede. Your goal is to knock out every single armor piece off the centipede, and it doesn't matter how many spears you use, it will not die. This is in my nightmares. And so, let's address the elephant in the room. Challenge 70. If you know, you know. I'm not going to touch on it right now, but I'll be going over that mess in the Saints section. But you aren't here for all those bits and pieces. I mean, maybe you are, I don't know the inner workings of your mind, but presumably, you're here for the real meat and potatoes. Speaking of meat... The Gourmand was one of the first slug cats we got any substantial information on, and by that I mean the sleep screen. We got the sleep screen. It is without a doubt the goofiest new slug cat and way more lighthearted than any of the others in terms of story. The Gourmand starts out with an odd drawing of itself surrounded by slime mold, which slowly fades into actual gameplay. Gourmand starts out in Shaded Citadel, which is well known to be everyone's favorite region. You get a couple of quick tutorials that briefly explain how the character works. If it eats 2 different foods at once, you make a meal, which gives you more food pips than you'd normally get. You also gain access to a basic crafting system. Some of the combinations make sense enough. Combine slime mold and a rock to get a lantern, a firecracker and a rock to get a grenade. But some of the recipes are questionable. The Gourmand's last food-related attribute is its ability to regurgitate random items at the cost of 1 food pip each. This includes living creatures, somehow. If you happen to find a popcorn plant, you're pretty much able to regurgitate indefinitely until the rain comes. Unfortunately, the crafting and spitting up mechanics are kind of niche. They can definitely be useful, but a lot of the crafting recipes are unintuitive. I only seriously used it a couple of times for very specific situations, like needing spore puffs to kill centipedes in Subterranean, where they don't really spawn. There are some super neat items you can get via crafting, but they require stupidly hard to get items, and it's just more practical to use what you have available to you most of the time. The spit-up mechanic has limited options on what you can get, and most of the time you're going to be throwing up batnip or snails, or god help you, a bubble fruit in Sky Islands. Where Gourmand really shines is its movement. One would think that weighing 5 times as any other slug cat would make you less mobile, and in some cases this is very true, but in action this thing can move. On flat ground, you can roll for an absurdly long time compared to other slug cats, and it makes traversing long stretches less of a pain. You can also slide real fast, and this can stun enemies. If you're a bit more adept with the moveset, Gourmand's extended slide is borderline silly, and in the best move any video game developer has ever done. Yes, you can damage enemies by falling on them. Nothing is immune to the immense weight of your giant ass. Vultures will crumple beneath you. Scavs will despise you. You can send batflies directly to the void sea like an angel from above. I am the Dropwig now.
That's enough about abilities, though. It's time to start talking about this guy's campaign.
So like I mentioned, you spawn in Shaded Citadel, but luckily it's a place that you're pretty easily able to escape. Now, while I have a lot to say about some of the other slug cats and their journeys, Gourmand is pretty straightforward. You go to Five Pebbles, he calls you fat, and then tells you to GTFO where you came from. It's the where you came from part that things actually get interesting. There is a new Karma Gate that can be accessed at the very beginning of Subterranean, and this leads you to my personal favorite new area, the Outer Expanse, with a palette of deep pinks and yellows, glimmering textures, and yeeks. This area was designed to be exotic and alien. It's a bit confusing to navigate, but then again, what Rainworld area isn't confusing to navigate? But as long as you just head west, you'll make it towards your goal. Journey's End is a subregion that essentially acts as a soft epilogue, winding down with very few threats. As Gourmand continues on its way, it encounters a slug cat, and then another, and then more! Journey's End, and largely Outer Expanse as a whole, is implied to be where the slug cats came from, like their natural habitat. As you make it to the large tree at the end, Gourmand's final slideshow plays. It shows a group of slug cats conversing over some murals of the Gourmand and its journey, and if you completed the food quest, it expands the cutscene by showing what the wiki calls the Gourmand coming back with a bountiful harvest. This ending, in the developer commentary, is stated to be the Gourmand initiating a migration of the slug cat population from Outer Expanse into Five Pebbles and Looks to the Moon region, which I think is really funny for the sole reason of pissing off the robot.
The last thing I want to touch on is an Easter egg left in by the developers. If you take a very specific path throughout the region, you'll end up in an area that bears a striking resemblance to the opening cutscene from the Survivor and Monk campaigns.
It will even play pictures of the past once you enter, and if you take the extremely smart action of leaping down into the giant pit here, it will bring you to the facility roots, which is a shortcut to the beginning of Outskirts, which does pretty much imply that this is where Survivor and Monk fell down. It's a really neat and easily missable detail that really gives testament to how much thought was put into these areas. Overall, the Gourmand campaign is fun, not very complex, in-depth, or emotional, but it's a sweet little romp that I definitely had fun with.
In my opinion, the main draw of doing the Gourmand campaign as well as the whole food quest is to unlock slug pups. Slug pups were originally cut content that were removed for the AI being not the best, but they were re-added with this DLC. If you complete the food quest, or cheat to get them, you will start seeing them in the Gourmand, Survivor, and Hunter campaigns. They'll be found in almost every region running around in or around shelters, and you can grab them or feed them and they'll begin following you. They are very cute, very stupid, and the devs have even confirmed themselves that their AI is not the best, even now. It is very easy to overlook the flaws of them being stupid as fuck because of their aforementioned cuteness, and the fact that they just add so much more replayability to the old campaigns. They are also surprisingly complicated. I recommend taking a look at the wiki if you're curious about how they work, because there is a lot more than you'd think. As a wrap-up on Gourmand, fat fuck, baby's good, eat food. And, try to enjoy the happiness while it lasts. A lot of the other campaigns don't necessarily cater to that.
the Artificer is unique, interesting, completely fucking batshit crazy, etc. The first 10 minutes of this campaign feel like I'm being hit by a truck and then tossed into a meat grinder.
The campaign fades into a pile of dead scavengers. You eat one, you explode to propel yourself through the air, you see text in the bottom left that tells you that you can make explosives at will, you approach a weird drone that activates and begins following you, you try to swim in a small pit of water and fucking explode, and when you make it to the first den, you see that you have a maximum of a whopping 1 karma. It's definitely a lot to take in at the start of the campaign, but it gives you a safe-ish playground to learn the new controls and mechanics, including the fact that you have permanently low rep with scavs, to the point where they actively seek to kill you and you have no choice but to fight back. The first thing I tried when I started this campaign was to give them a pearl. That doesn't work very well. Now, if you're like me, you'll get stuck in this opening area for 30 minutes because the karma gate in the shaded is 4, but you can only get 1. I'm not that good at math, but that doesn't add up. If you're not an idiot, you'll realize that when you pick up a scavenger corpse, your karma goes up temporarily. Luckily, the max of 1 karma has both downsides and upsides. This causes the Artificer to have the coolest difficulty curve out of all the new Slugcats. If it's your first playthrough and you're going generally in the direction the game points you in, dying is not much of a consequence at all. Your karma can't go higher than 1 anyways. This helps offset the harder enemy spawns and extreme aggression of the scavengers. It makes death as Artificer a lot less frustrating because you no longer need a karma farm. The only exception to this is if you actively seek out the echoes, and I'll get more into that later, but if you are looking for echoes as this thing, you clearly already know what you're doing and are able to handle harder enemies while balancing your karma level. Anyways, Artificer also happens to have the potential shortest campaign of any of the Slugcats. The route I took this run was Garbage Wastes into Shaded into the Exterior into 5 Pebbles, though Wastes into Shaded into Industrial into Chimney Canopy into the Exterior into 5 Pebbles is also feasible and probably faster. While I normally advocate for giving unfortunate development the cold shoulder, it's not that bad as Artificer. Due to being so early in the timeline, 5 Pebbles is not nearly as infected with the rot as he is in later campaigns, and because of your ability to explode on command, you can easily change directions to avoid what little dangers there are. Now, the title of this video says Downpour Review and Analysis, but a large chunk of that is going to be my 5 Pebbles opinions. I'd say that out of any character in Downpour, he is the one that gets the most expanded development, but this is especially true in the Artificer campaign. Upon entering his chamber, he gives you the mark of communication, and explains that the drone that you have is marking you as a citizen of the city. Because Looks to the Moon is blocked off as Artificer, 5 Pebbles effectively replaces Moon in this campaign. Unlike the other Slugcats, 5 Pebbles literally cannot force you to leave or kill you. He doesn't have a lot of dialogue like Moon, but he will let you hang out and may comment on certain things. You can bring almost every pearl that you can bring to Moon to Pebbles, and he will share his own thoughts and feelings on them. He will give a lot less dialogue on pearls that he sees as trivial and does not read out conversations word for word like Moon does. A couple of interesting ones are the gold pearl you find in Chimney Canopy, which contains the information sent by 7 Red Suns to help 5 Pebbles attempt to rewrite his own genome, which is ultimately what ended up in giving him the rot. While Moon explains what it says and how it works, 5 Pebbles laments on the fact that he wasn't able to do it correctly, and that in doing so he lost his only close friend. In the Pearl, when Moon uses Force Communications to contact Pebbles, she will read it to you verbatim despite the discomfort she gets from reading it, and Pebbles will react with anger and demand you take the Pearl and leave. The last one is my personal favorite one. It's very small, but these last 2 lines are so incredibly important for his character. When you talk to people, you learn to recognize when they're talking about things that they're interested in or passionate about. Before Downpour, Pebbles had none of this. But in this transcription, we see him using an exclamation mark, not in anger, not in resentment, but in excitement, and he thanks the Slugcat, deeming them a worthy citizen. It seems like something reasonably small to get so worked up over, but giving him even the tiniest hobby or personality humanizes him so much, and even though he's still upset towards Moon and 7 Red Suns, it makes you sympathize with him. He's no longer just a smug sociopath with no regards to other people, he's just angry, scared, and guilty. The player bringing him pearls is a small reprieve from this, and the fact that he acknowledged this enough to let down his guard and be genuinely thankful for the artificer is something that really gets to me. One last small detail before we move on. As you bring him pearls, the ones he takes interest in, he will store permanently in the bottom right of his chamber. Moon also does this in the Spearmaster campaign. I just think that's really cute. Back on track, after you receive the mark, he comments on how he finds your way of life appalling. However, he will take advantage of that, as there is a pack of scavengers that have been causing him grief. This conversation unlocks the gate to Metropolis. Metropolis is an expansive and grand area that is designed specifically with Artificer and their movement in mind. It has beautiful visuals, music, unique areas, and even a few pearls. It is really interesting to see Pebble's city and speculate on how it would have looked and functioned when everyone was still around. Naturally, Metropolis is teeming with scavengers, as well as a new variant of them, the Elite Scavengers. Despite the fact that you've likely only traveled a few cycles to get here, Metropolis is one of the final areas in the Artificer campaign. So, let's take a step back and talk about why this Slugcat ended up here. Every few cycles, Artificer will have increasingly distressing dreams featuring itself and its two slug pups. The first couple of dreams are innocuous. You have the ability to play as one of the pups for a brief period of time before the Artificer wakes up. I remember my first time playing this campaign, I was streaming it to a friend, and we saw the first dream, and our collective minds went, "Oh, they brought slug pups back!" to, "Oh, the Artificer doesn't have a scar in this dream," to, "Oh no!" A few dreams later, it shows the family crossing through a scav toll. Not only do they not pay to get through, but one of the pups steals a pearl on the way. The next few dreams are intense, showing one of the pups get left behind with a group of angry scavengers, and the other one falling off of Artificer's back mid-jump and into the water, being drowned by leeches. All the while, each of these dreams has more disturbing intro music than the last. It doesn't take a genius to figure out why this thing has a vendetta against scavengers. As you explore Metropolis, you'll eventually end up in the 12th Council Pillar House of Braids, where the Scavenger Chieftain resides. There are two alarming things that come to light here. The Scavenger Chief not only has its own citizen ID drone, but it also has the mark of communication. The implications of these things are a bit worrying. The chief will actually not attack you outright and instead vigorously point to the left, urging you to leave. It only becomes hostile once you attack it or, oddly enough, present it with a gift. After the battle is triggered, the chief jumps to the right of the screen and regular and elite scavengers pour out of the left side. These scavengers are largely passive and tend to not attack you unless you attempt to leave the arena. The battle really is between you and the chief alone. Unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on how good you are at Ringworld combat, the fight is very quick. The chief does have armoring in the form of red centipede shells, but because of Artificer's butt blast that causes everything around you to cease bodily function for around 5 seconds, it's not much of a challenge. Everything comes to a halt when the chief dies. Oh. Uh-oh. The game fades out and displays your current karma level. If you had gained any via echoes by this point, it is shown phasing down to the bottom level and flashing a deep red. It then shows Artificer standing over the chief's body and slaughtering the rest of the scavengers present. The game awards you with the achievement Closure and fades into the credits. You are allowed to continue playing after this ending, but with a few changes. Most notably, your maximum karma is now 1, regardless of how many echoes you met beforehand. This cannot be increased by any means other than holding scavenger corpses. Scavengers themselves are now completely non-hostile. You can approach, steal from, and kill them without any resistance, and they will actively avoid you. The mask you get after killing the Chieftain Scavenger also acts as a vulture mask. You are rewarded with an incredibly powerful item at the cost of your karma being permanently flocked. Now, before facing off against the Scavenger Chief, there's a large chance that you stumbled across atop the tallest tower. An echo that urges you to find a way out if you still can. Hi there, gamers. Mid-editing Fletcher here with some fun facts and new information. So if you've already played Downpour, you might notice that a lot of the echoes don't really seem to have names. I just referred to this echo by its subregion name, which is pretty silly of me.
But a few days before I got to editing this part, we actually had a conversation with some of the developers of the More Slugcats team. Originally, the Echoes were intended to have names. The only reason they don't show up is because Echo names are revealed through achievements, and some of the console ports are going to have limited amounts of achievements. The team wanted the amount of achievements across platforms to be consistent, so they don't actually show up in-game at all. Either way, I just wanted to take this segment to let you know that the Atop the Tallest Tower Echo is actually known as 12 Beads Among Burning Skies. Pretty much immediately after I achieved the closure ending, I knew that Ascension with Artificer was possible, so I restarted my game and I made the pilgrimage.
Unfortunately, due to starting out with a maximum karma of 1, it's impossible to get to a karma level of 10 with the echoes available to you. The only way to reach maximum karma is by carrying a scavenger corpse into the depths. This does fool the guardians, but it does not fool the void worm. And where it would usually hook the slug cat and drag it to ascension, it simply leaves the artificer in the void, causing its body to disintegrate in the void fluid. The end cutscene is triggered, showing Artificer reuniting with its pups for a brief moment before dissolving. Both of Artificer's endings are extremely upsetting for completely different reasons. The closure ending, due to Artificer giving into its rage, losing any chance it ever had at peace, as it embraces its own vengeance towards the things that hurt it most. The void ending isn't much better, because even though the Artificer did its very best to heal past what happened, to raise its karma and work past the grief, it still isn't enough. No matter what it does, its soul is still bound to the world, and it won't ever truly find that peace. And honestly, I think that's an extremely powerful and fitting ending. Not everyone gets over their grief or trauma. Some people don't have happy endings even when they do their best. And as someone who would vehemently attempt to befriend scavengers before Artificer, it made me reconsider how I viewed them. This was the first campaign I played when I downloaded Downpour, and it did not set the tone very well for any of the others. A quick Google search of the word rivulet gives the definition: error, Google cannot connect to the internet, please refresh the page or try again later. Rivulet attempts the ambitious goal of making swimming not terrible in this game, and in that regard, it succeeds somewhat, but honestly, its underwater qualities take a backseat to literally everything else in this campaign. This thing's movement is absolutely bonkers, just its walking speed is over twice as fast as Survivor, it can backflip half a mile in the air, and its slide is so fast that the physics can't keep up and this can happen. This isn't a super meta tech speedrunner strat either, this can and will happen accidentally if you utilize the slide at all. The increased lung capacity is definitely cool, and it does make being underwater more fun than annoying, but Rivulet really shines when on land. You'd think it might do less damage due to being light and seemingly pretty frail, but Rivulet has the same damage as Survivor, so you can actually kill things quite efficiently if you can work around how slippery the controls are. Rivulet starts in drainage system. They really did go out of their way to make the new slug cat spawn in the worst possible regions. The first thing you'll notice when starting Rivulet campaign is that the cycles are outrageously short, being as tiny as 2.5 minutes to get from one shelter to the next. Luckily, Rivulet can easily make its way across half a region in that time frame, so as long as you're at least not lumbering around, it shouldn't be too much of a problem. Shelter failures are also very, very common when playing as Rivulet, requiring you to deal with special spawns and the inconvenient rain for about 5 minutes at the start of a cycle. This is more of an annoyance than a detriment, however, as the cycle doesn't actually start until the pre-cycle rain has elapsed. Rivulet also starts with the mark of communication and a pearl in their stomach, one that contains some graphics of an iterator's structure, including directions on how to break in. Now, while I love Rivulet's movement, story, and overall campaign, it is actually one of my least favorite slug cats for one very glaring reason. The Rot. I am a known unfortunate development hater, and the Rot has indeed consumed in this point in the timeline. Both the Memory Crypts and the Underhang have been taken over by Daddy Longlegs, but the real issue is Five Pebbles itself. When I first played Rain World, I went through the Five Pebbles region once and never again. I will take plummeting into a white lizard's jaws and chimney canopy any day over gracefully drifting into the arms of this bitch that has a 50% chance of being on the left or right at any given moment. Not only is there an abundance of daddy and mother longlegs, come on guys, don't be coward, call them mommy longlegs. but the entire area has transformed into my own personal hell, which even Andrew, the lead developer of Downpour, states is large and confusing, and he won't even touch the maps to put them onto the wiki. What have you done? Going through this area is a headache. I had about 3 deaths getting to 5 pebbles, and about 40 after going through the rut. This place sucks. After you battle the urge to ascend yourself while clamoring through the turbo cancer, you eventually make it to 5 Pebbles' chamber, where he is being serenaded by a pearl playing a hymn. He is both frustrated and pleased by your visit. 5 Pebbles laments on his past actions, his failures, and then asks the Rivulet to acquire his last remaining rarefaction cell, essentially the only thing keeping him functional, and deliver it to Moon as a last act of sacrifice.
And because the developers of this game are hilarious and terrible, there is a patch of proto-longlegs right outside of his chamber that is extremely easy to fall into, and then 5 Pebbles calls you a dumbass.
There you go.
Yep. Wow.
You deserve
that, honestly. Side note, but 5 Pebbles tells you that the rarefaction cell resides deep within the facility, and I thought, oh, there's a subregion of the rot called the Depths. It must be there, right? It was not. After finally finding the rarefaction cell and removing it, the fluctuating gravity in the area stops, and the cycles return to their normal length. 5 Pebbles thanks you for your assistance and sends you on your way.
The Rivulet campaign really does do a wonderful job of making you feel pity for 5 Pebbles. And regardless of if it was intentional or not, there are a lot of similarities by Pebbles' situation and someone who is very, very depressed. During essentially the entire duration of the time period where Rainworld takes place, 5 Pebbles is straight up suicidal, so desperate to escape the eternal cycle that he asks his close friend for instructions on how to essentially kill himself. In doing this, he not only loses said close friend, but nearly kills Looks to the Moon as well as a result. Not to mention the, you know, turbo cancer. So instead of getting the quick, painless, and profound death that he was aiming for, he's instead alone rotting away with the knowledge that he hurt everyone he was close to. And if you've ever had those kinds of thoughts before, you'd know that that is a very, very real feeling. After presenting Moon with the rarefaction cell, she explains what it is and vaguely where to take it. Another nice detail is that at this point, 5 Pebbles' overseer will show up and start guiding you on generally where the location is. It's unclear as to whether 5 Pebbles is actually controlling the Overseer or not, but I like to think that he's trying to help. So you make your way into the submerged superstructure, which is the one area in the game where Rivulet might actually struggle for air. This place is huge. It is the biggest map in all of Downpour. It acts as a giant underwater maze where you go through the remains of Moon's superstructure after her collapse. Eventually, you come across an area known as the Heart.
This is where you insert the orb and essentially jumpstart Moon's systems again. This causes a current of water to violently toss the Rivulet around, resulting in them being flushed into a new region, the Bitter Airy. Bitter Airy is essentially a counterpart to Metropolis, though not nearly as big or in depth. It's the first time the player will encounter snow in the game, and is a total tone shift compared to the rest of the campaign. You'll eventually find your way back to Moon's chamber and are met with my personal favorite ending, which is heartfelt and definitely bittersweet. Since Moon's communications are functional again, she sends out a message directed at 5 Pebbles, stating that she isn't mad anymore and that she cares about him and wants him to respond.
The ending slideshow for the Rivulet campaign is one of the shortest in the entire game, showing only 2 slides of 5 Pebbles receiving the communications from Moon. And a small side tangent here, but I've noticed that some of the art looks inconsistent in Downpour. Don't get me wrong, it is all beautiful and very, very well done, but the styles just don't match up very well. Take for instance the Survivor and Monk Outer Expanse ending art. It's very good, but it just doesn't fit the rest of the game. And 5 Pebbles here is just very off model. His eyes are really small, his antennae are really big, he doesn't have either the dots on his head or his little eyeliner things. It's all very, very good work, just inconsistent and a little jarring. And side note, I just wanted to say that I am still obsessed with Annoying Flower's unused Rivulet starting screen. Just look at this fucking thing. Need I say more?
Anyways, despite how frustrating some of this campaign was, it was probably my favorite ending in all of Downpour. Having 5 Pebbles reconnect with Moon is the best possible outcome here, and it shows that 5 Pebbles is at peace with his current situation.
You can actually return to his chamber after completing the main story, and he will properly thank you, saying that he finally understands what everyone was trying to tell him, that he doesn't have to go through this alone. If only the preceding campaign didn't make him look like a huge asshole. Spearmaster is purple. I like purple, so I like Spearmaster. In terms of world-building lore and story, Spearmaster is without a doubt the campaign that contributes the most. In addition, Spearmaster has a highly unconventional playstyle. Not having a mouth obviously has the drawback of not being able to eat corpses normally, but has the secondary drawbacks of being unable to store anything in your stomach, as well as not really being able to be a pacifist.
You can, however, make an infinite amount of spears and dual-wield them.
This allows you to shred through most regular enemies. The downside is that a lot of the spawns in Spearmaster is anything but regular. The campaign starts with Spearmaster on the other side of a karma gate from Outer Expanse into Outskirts. A unique red overseer belonging to Seven Red Suns keeps an eye on you as you move. While it doesn't sound so bad that you spawn in Outskirts, like I said, these spawns are really, really mean. The first time I tried to play Spearmaster, I got about 5 minutes in, saw two red lizards, and gave up immediately because I don't need that kind of drama in my life right now. I guess that they had to balance out the infinite spears thing somehow, but they already do, in a worse, more horrible way.
Anyways, the main gimmick of the slug behind the slaughter, if you don't count the spears and no mouth thing, is that these little broadcast satellites are scattered around the world. Spearmaster alone adds the most world-building of any campaign, and I will die on this hill. There are 65 different collection entries, 35 of them are Spearmaster broadcast. Not only that, but an additional 7 entries are only accessible as Spearmaster through pearls. This little shit had its organs replaced with lore.
On the topic of no organs, Spearmaster is so light compared to the other slug cats that if you grab a squid cata and backflip with it, you fly forever. This can only be done normally if your slug cat is starving, but Spearmaster, in its regular, non-starving form, weighs less than a regular starving slug cat.
So what do these broadcasts say? They mainly consist of conversations between No Significant Harassment and Seven Red Suns, which is awesome, as these are two iterators that got barely any characterization in the base game. Sorry, Chasing Wind. I still love you. The conversations reveal that Spearmaster is a messenger that was created and sent by Seven Red Suns in order to contact 5 Pebbles. Spearmaster is the earliest slug cat in the timeline, and the only character that can actually access Looks to the Moon pre-collapse. Yes, this slug that already has an insane amount of lore behind it is also able to actually explore Looks to the Moon. Your main goal, though, is to first and foremost reach 5 Pebbles, with the broadcast slowly uncovering that Suns is the one who gave 5 Pebbles the instructions on how to pretty much kill himself, and those big-brained among us will realize that this is ultimately what led to Moon's collapse. Now, I know I said our goal is to go to 5 Pebbles first, but for the sake of this video, I did give myself the mark of communication so we can go over what exactly happens. 5 Pebbles expresses disappointment and unease at Seven Red Sun's persistent intrusion, and then proceeds to rip a pearl out of Spearmaster's chest. While you writhe around on the ground and bleed, 5 Pebbles narrates the pearl, which is essentially proving that Seven Red Suns has no idea how to talk to or console people, and ends up making the situation 10 times worse by being extremely patronizing, saying,
"Pebbles, I send you this message as your concerned and longtime friend. Unparalleled innocence had sent an overseer to your can, and we've all observed the state that you are in. I know this is my fault. I know I should have foreseen that you'd be too desperate to escape your situation to do things in proper moderation. For that, I am very, very sorry. However, please don't disable your communication modules. You don't have to go through this alone. Everyone has been trying to contact you. We only want to help you. I know better than anyone how you can be about these things, but it doesn't have to happen this way. Please respond back."
I agree with Pebbles on this one. Astounding. He then proceeds to murk Seven Red Suns' overseer and force Spearmaster out of the chamber. After that, you get to watch Suns have a panic attack live on broadcast. From here on out, the campaign turns into a really dumb escort mission. This pearl is essentially your key to beating the game. If you lose it, you're locked out of the unique ending and can only reset or ascend. Since Spearmaster doesn't have a mouth, you will have to give up one of your hand slots for the pearl. Your goal from here is to make your way to Looks to the Moon, which, in a pleasant surprise, hasn't collapsed yet. You're able to explore the entirety of the region, and I'll be honest, it's not my favorite. Don't get me wrong, it's beautiful and I love the themes and aesthetics, but it's just a maze. It's just 5 Pebbles with very few hazards, and they'll have you going around in circles until you stumble into a big room, and you can see where her chamber is, but you can't access it from that room, and the music is so loud for no goddamn reason, I can't hear my thoughts. Oh my god.
Oh my god, Moon, shut up.
Luna is very pretty, though. The region kind of makes up for it by allowing us to meet Moon in her, well, I wouldn't say her prime, but she's not naked and has access to the Rainworld wiki, so better than usual. She takes a nap and then looks at the pearl with your guts on it before rewriting it with her own message and directing you to the communications array in Sky Islands. Pray to God you have a passage so you don't have to run all the way through this region again. There are many more broadcasts than the ones you find leading up to Pebbles, and a lot of them surround Suns and Harassment just talking about various topics. This not only expands the world, but the characters as well. Since Five Pebbles nukes Suns' overseers, they are unable to watch Spearmaster's journey. In a couple of broadcasts, you can see Suns grow worried and eventually fond of the Spearmaster, who was originally just intended to be an experimental messenger. We also get to learn more about NSH. He's just as cynical as always, but gets a bit serious in a couple of broadcasts. There's something very unsettling about NSH being blunt and straightforward. There's also this one. Even as Five Pebbles is harming wild animals and killing his big sister, I still can't help but feel awful for him. Once you make it to Communications Array, your pearl transmits Moon's message, which is essentially a goodbye as she is absolutely about to die, no matter what. It's honestly kind of underwhelming and melancholic, but it's all okay because yes! Woo! Let's go! We finally get official art of another iterator. Not only that, but oh, it is so precious. It also confirms that Spearmaster manages to make its way back to Suns alive. It's just so heartwarming and probably my favorite ending art. Unlike many of the other campaigns, there's really nothing special to do after this ending. If you continue the save file as Gourmand, you'd spawn with two pups. If you continue as Artificer, you'd get the Chieftain mask. If you continue as Rivulet, you get a very cute cutscene with Moon where she calls you Ruffles. But Spearmaster is just kinda there. Despite some of the more annoying spawns and the god-awful escort mission, Spearmaster is one of the best pieces of content in the expansion. Would you believe that it was almost cut? In the dev commentary, it's revealed that Spearmaster was very, very close to being axed due to just not feeling like it fit in. I appreciate Spearmaster just for the characterizations of Suns and Harassment alone. It's just incredibly interesting to watch the two iterators converse about the current situation. It brings a new perspective onto everything and how they're just two friends looking at something that they can't do anything about. It makes everything feel so much more human. They are literally sitting in a Discord chat, looking at that one friend who always causes problems leave the Discord server, and they're trying to figure out how to contact him to tell him to calm the fuck down and that it's not that big of a deal. It's all really, really cool to see, even if Suns is the absolute fucking worst at talking to people. Saint is the final campaign of the game, and it really does deserve that placement. This is easily the most difficult campaign out of all of the new Slug Cats, mostly due to the fact that the Saint cannot utilize any weapons to defend itself. You can use rocks to stun stuff, but attempting to throw spears will result in it just kinda sadly spinning and falling on the ground. On top of that, it also cannot consume any sort of meat. Attempting to eat batflies or centipedes will result in the Saint falling onto the ground, being stunned for a moment. With the exception of egg bug eggs, for some reason. Also, blue fruit is confirmed to be meat anyways, so I'm... Make it make sense, Andrew. Either way, meat is out, plants are in, and it is winter. They did it, guys. They took the rain out of Rainworld. Another interesting mechanic that may not be obvious at first is the fact that the Saint is very, very, very frail. You know how lizard bites usually have a percent chance to actually kill you outright? With Saint, that check is completely gone, and any attacks that do have that percent chance will always kill you no matter what. In addition, attacks that normally just stun you have a much higher effect. For instance, if you're shocked by an infant centipede, you will receive an exhaustion debuff, similar to when Gourmand throws a spear, or a Slugcat is starving and jumps around too much. You also just straight up have a seizure if you get popped by a snail at any point, and it's really funny. This campaign takes place so far in the future that the rain has turned to snow so harsh that Slugcats have evolved fur, and lizards have evolved horns. The Saint spawns in sky, windswept spires? Yeah, nearly every region has been renamed to reflect the new setting and extreme passage of time, and it does a very good job of setting an uneasy tone right from the start. But while my brain is short-circuiting, my ears are grooving. The Saint campaign features some of the best music in the entire game. Sheer Ice Torrent never fails to get me hyped up. After starting, the game throws a blizzard at you at full force, requiring you to move quickly. It spawns a dead scavenger right outside the first shelter that has a lantern. This thing is your best friend. Put it in your tummy. because there is no rain, there are no cycles. Instead, Saint has a temperature meter that you must keep up in order to avoid freezing. You can warm up by standing inside near a lantern or other heat source, though holding a lantern outside stops your heat from falling too fast. Similarly to Artificer, Saint does not start with a maximum of 5 karma, instead being offered only 2. This sucks because while you could get away with only visiting a couple of echoes as Artificer, and then just drag a scavenger to the void with you, Saint has to visit every single echo in order to reach 10 karma. There is one act of mercy though, as Saint can see echoes at any karma level without activating them first. All of the echoes have new dialogue reflecting their original monologues while also acknowledging how long they've been there. So obviously, your goal here is to ascend, and as mentioned, you have to visit all the echoes. There are 2 small problems here. You are spawned in pretty much the middle of all the echoes, meaning you're gonna have to backtrack somewhere no matter what, and Saint, for whatever reason, can't use passages, meaning you have to walk it all on foot, and believe you me, we'll touch on that later. Anyways, since you start out in Sky Islands, you're able to grab that echo, and I believe the game is trying to lead you to the wall. You hit Sky Islands, get that echo, go to Chimney, get that echo, then you have exactly enough karma to access the wall. So you make your way over there and... Fuck. This marks the exact point where Downpour becomes not only Rain World but more, but not Rain World at all. There's something uniquely disturbing about exploring this world which you've come to know almost intimately in such a dilapidated state, but to have an entire region just vanish completely turns this all on its head. And even if you're not a huge lore buff or don't really care about the story of this game, specifically the wall being missing is very, very concerning. Either way, the absence of the exterior means that you're kind of on your own route-wise. Being capped at 4 karma at this point means that you can't go to Shaded Citadel, and I don't particularly want to go to Farm Arrays right now. So, for some reason, I decided that the next best course of action was to go to Drainage System. Unlike other areas that just have a name change or palette swap, Drainage System takes the form of a humid jungle, now being known as the Undergrowth. It feels like a new region, even though a lot of the rooms are the same and you take the same general path through it. It's one of the only regions that is almost entirely unaffected by the cold, and as such is the one place where pole mimics will spawn in the Saint campaign. The developers are laughing at you. It is happening. Now, the main draw to coming to Undergrowth is the echo that's here, and no drainage system doesn't normally have an echo, but in this point in the timeline there happens to be one. And this is probably the most interesting new echo that's been added in Downpour. It introduces a character that did not want to ascend. The only thing we've ever seen from the ancients is how desperate they are to escape the cycle, so it's pretty refreshing to see someone who has a differing opinion. However, this monologue does paint a pretty disturbing picture due to the fact that the only way that we've seen something can become an echo is due to bathing in void fluid when your ego is too big in some fashion. And this pretty much implies that this person was forced to ascend. Either way, it's incredibly interesting and a very good new perspective on some of the things that happened within this world. At this point, you should be at 5 karma and you're free to leave Drainage System. From here, you go to Farm Arrays, which is now known as Desolate Fields, and get the echo here. There's not a lot changed here, and it's honestly not pretty interesting, aside from the fact that yeeks spawn here now. And despite being incredibly goofy, they are very helpful because it means you don't need to use the reindeer to get across the worm grass. Then you can dip into Subterranean, which is now known as the Primordial Underground, a name that goes incredibly hard. At this point, you should be at 8 karma, so it's time to start backtracking. So, you head to Shoreline. Now known as the Frigid Coast, there's still only one thing that people really care about in this region, so let's talk about Looks to the Moon. She's not only still alive, but still as functional as she was at the end of the Rivulet campaign. She has not gotten a lot done, she's still staring at that same picture, but she seems happy enough, so, you know, good for her. It is still a really cool comparison to see her like this compared to how you first met her on your first playthrough of the vanilla game. I did gloss over one thing, being that on your very first meeting with her in this campaign, you actually can't talk to her. This is also a good time to mention that Saint does not have the mark of communication, yet it can still understand everything that speaks to it. In addition, it can see void spawn without having eaten a neuron. The trek to this echo has you going across Luna, which is as pretty as ever, and this should leave you at 9 karma. Normally, you'd either go to the wall or Shaded Citadel at this point, and... Well, so 5 Pebbles was built over Shaded Citadel, and the exterior's gone. There's only one place where it went. Shaded Citadel is now known as the Frosted Cathedral and has essentially been reduced into a sub-region. It has more or less been combined with Five Pebbles, which is now as a whole known as the Silent Construct. Spiders, Miros birds, and lantern mice have migrated from the Citadel into the remnants of Five Pebbles' structure. The rot has completely consumed and petrified throughout the building, leaving only one single brother longlegs that crumples in the blizzard at the end of each cycle. This region, conceptually, is brilliant. And as you scale these metallic mountains, with every single screen transition, all you can think is he alive? Is Five Pebbles okay? What's going on? And eventually, when you get close enough, you'll hear his music pearl playing, although distorted by time. And at that point, all you can really think is, oh fuck, I wish he was dead. Five Pebbles essentially went from being a late-stage cancer patient to a late-stage dementia patient. Unironically, he can only form sentences 2 or 3 words long, and it takes him quite a while to think of it, too. He doesn't greet the player with any hostility or spice like he used to. Instead, he's docile, calm, and, surprised, if you can even call it that. If you're a fucking sadist, you can take his music pearl and he will beg you to give it back. If you come back on subsequent cycles, he will talk to you about certain things, trying to make conversations about the weather, or even just acknowledging you as his friend. He also has special dialogue if you die right in front of him. Probably the most fucked up thing, though, is if you take his pearl and have it read by Moon, she will say this to you.
This pearl is still warm, and there's only one reason why that could be. Please, return this. I'm sure what little is left of him misses this dearly. Our creators chose to abandon us, taking a gamble and vanishing from the world, leaving us behind to simply keep working on their problem. I understand why he did what he did.
This is heartbreaking. Even after everything Five Pebbles did to hurt Moon and everyone around him, she still asks you to bring back his pearl so he can have that last comfort.
As much as I hate the position he's in, I gotta say that this was probably the best way that the team could have handled his arc. It is incredibly powerful, both impressive and horrifying that he's still alive after everything. After acting as a space heater for a little bit, it's time for you to depart and obtain your last echo.
This is actually the same echo that was in the original exterior, it just got nudged a little bit.
With this, your karma has finally reached the maximum of 10. The game shows this sick-ass cutscene and then hits you with the flight tutorial?
The next text box you're gonna get is the most insane thing ever.
Is it gonna be from Moon?
Congratulations, you have hit 10 karma and are now God. You can fly and ascend things at will. Yes, the last stretch of this campaign gives you a brain blast insta-kill move that deletes the souls of anything it touches. Batflies, lizards, Miros birds, leviathans, and, let's just consider that a mercy killing. So, now that we are God and also Jesus, what are we to do? Well, what else than to ascend? So let's head to Subterranean. Now, something to note is that the void effects that normally happen in the depths have somehow leaked up into filtration system. You are not supposed to be seeing this many void spawn this high up. This is the first of many signs that something is very wrong. The second of these signs is that the depths is fucking gone. It left. Goodbye. In its place is a brand new area called the Rubicon. Oh boy, this region. So, Rubicon is interesting. Instead of a slow, calm, and melancholy ending like the depths that has relatively few hazards and drags on for a little bit too long, Rubicon is stressful and incredibly dangerous. There are red lizards, red centipedes, Miros vultures, firebugs. What the hell is a firebug? These things have some of the most unique interactions in the game. Hitting them with a rock or spear causes them to explode, launching their eggs everywhere and causing them to become violent. Their eggs can be eaten or thrown, they stick to whatever they hit, and explode around 4 seconds later. They do 75 damage. What the hell? When the firebugs dies, it drops cool spears that do triple damage of normal spears. And unlike regular spears, Saint can actually use these. One small problem, very small tiny little issue. I can brain blast anything into the void. Why would I ever use this? These creatures only appear in this one area. They are so out of place. Why are you here? What purpose do you serve? I hate you. Okay, so Rubicon, unlike the depths where you go down, you want to be going up here. As I mentioned earlier, this area is completely filled with enemies from hard mode. Red lizards, cyan lizards, etc. There are also pools of void fluid that act as a hazard, as when you touch them, pee!
pee, dude?
Why is the pee explosive?
And as you traverse room to room, you will occasionally encounter guardians which prevent you from leaving until you've ascended them. You eventually come across rooms that look a bit familiar, mirroring other locations from throughout the game. There's also this room. As you get closer to the end, a reverse version of Pictures of the Past plays, and it actually sounds pretty amazing. The last area mimics an iterator structure, and the final room before the ending is an iterator chamber. This chamber can either be empty, contain 5 pebbles, moon, or both. In this run, I just ascended Pebbles to get his specific dialogue. Both Moon and Pebbles' individual dialogue concern the saint and the nature of their existence.
I understand what you are, little beast.
Stating that they can't see their beginning or their end. It's actually kind of bittersweet if you ascend them both. The conversation is cryptic, but, I don't know, nostalgic? Moon referring to Pebbles as an old friend did 500 psychic damage to me. Either way, regardless of which one you ascended, they disappear and leave you alone for the rest of your journey. You swim upwards into the Void Sea, past all of the Void Worms, and then you have your fateful encounter.
The vibe check.
Oh, I'm alone. God, don't worry.
Kill him. Do it!
Oh my god.
Bro made an error.
Well, that can't be good. Yep. The game forcefully takes away control and ascends the Void Worm. This causes Saint's Karma to violently regress to 0. Not 1. 0. Welcome to Karma Jail, motherfucker. As you continue to swim upwards, tendrils form on your body, and you complete your transformation into a magic space octopus. Despite the confusing and ambiguous nature of this entire ending, the final cutscene is genuinely beautiful. Except when my fucking graphics break.
That's what you get for using mods.
What mod could possibly cause this?
Reclaiming Entropy, the name of the final song, elicits such a strong emotion. It's not sadness, I'm not sure what the fuck I'm feeling right now, but it is not happy. After tallying your score, it displays the ending art. A very cool detail that this triggers is even if you restart your game, this ending art will not change. This reflects the fact that Saint is an echo and is stuck in their own messed up cycle, which I think is pretty neat. Now that we've covered the bulk of Saint's campaign, let's take a little detour to talk about that Challenge 70, huh?
Woo! It is hot as hell in this funky ass, hot ass room I'm in. Is that the Grim Reaper?
So, after completing all 69 of the other challenges, you are faced with this. One enemy, sliver of straw, and one goal, ascend all enemies. Those of you familiar with the lore of Rainworld should find this concerning, but I want to talk about the actual fight first. The entire ordeal takes place in zero gravity and spans 6 phases that range from mind-numbingly boring to proof that God isn't real but somehow still hates you. Phase 1 has her shooting lasers at you that will either push you into the wall or kill you if you are already against the wall. Phase 2 has you avoiding ascension symbols that show up in a square pattern around the chamber. Phase 3 has you avoiding a radial pattern of lasers that fire one after the other. Phase 4 is an affront to God. Phase 5 has you navigate an increasingly small safe circle of orbs that move in a figure 8 pattern. And Phase 6 is the orbs again, but on the top and bottom third of the screen, and with some lasers thrown in for fun. Between each phase, Sliver's gravity field goes down and you have to ascend her again to progress. The entire fight, give or take, is around 5 minutes, which might not seem too bad, but keep in mind that each death sends you back to the start of the fight. Every time you fail to phase 4, you have to sit through phase 1, 2, and 3 again, and it doesn't matter how good you are, you will die to RNG bullshit even if you've mastered the movement. Don't get me wrong, I love bullet hells, but the fun part of bullet hells is that they combine incredibly precise movement with incredibly precise obstacles. This is not fucking precise. It would be different if they gave us infinite ascension juice, but it is very easy to run out, and if you use your ascension powers too much, you won't be able to go to the next phase because the window in which you can ascend Sliver is very limited. Needing to micromanage these things is not fun in the slightest. Having to redo all of the phases again is not fun, and having to do it all in a silent chamber with only ambient humming is not fun. And before anyone says, oh, it's Rainworld, it's supposed to be hard, this is not hard. There is a difference between hard and unfair. Take a look at another bullet hell, like Just Shapes and Beats. These levels are intricately crafted and incredibly fine-tuned in order to offer a tough,
but fair experience. I'm not saying at all that this couldn't have been done well. I am saying that their first thought should not have been bullet hell for an epic final boss. Shapes and Beats levels are super hard, but the controls are incredibly tight, there are several checkpoints throughout the levels in case you do happen to die, and I think it goes without saying that just Shapes and Beats has better music than Challenge 70. A platformer where your protagonist has the same physics as a bag of flour is not exactly the ideal candidate for something like this. The first time I beat Challenge 70, I actually cheated to do it. The first time, I actually did go back and beat it legitimately on an energy drink fueled binge, just so you couldn't skill issue me to death. The thing that's baffling me is that not only is an achievement locked behind this, but so is dev commentary. Why? Yes, you can use the More Slugcats cheats menu to just cheat it in, which I recommend you do, rather than going through this, but why dev commentary? I just don't get it. Now, I don't want to get into the lore implications too much, but I am still baffled at why the More Slugcats team decided to take this character, known for being the only iterator to send out the triple affirmative, and pit it against the character, known for being able to ascend things, and then declare that Challenge 70 is not canon? You are leading people to a conclusion, only to then state out of game and after the fact that it is not canon. In a game which the story is so centered on the viewer figuring out what's going on and drawing their own conclusions, having to state offhand somewhere in a Discord server where 90% of people won't see it that what has just happened is not canon doesn't really work well. Conceptually, I love this fight. It's a great idea, a good payoff for completing all of the challenges, but they took a wrong turn at every point. Challenge 70 as a whole just was not designed well. And that's all I really have to say about that. So let's draw a conclusion on the Saint campaign. The Saint has its problems. It creates more questions than answers, and it can be a bit too cryptic at times. But the questions that it does answer, it does very well. I loved seeing the world change. I loved seeing structures that I'd climbed so many times on the brink of collapse. As much as it hurt, I loved seeing five pebbles on the brink of death because it was able to bring those emotions out of me. It's the kind of tragic story that I'm a sucker for, and it just all wraps it up so nice. Saint really does work as not only an epilogue to Downpour, but to the story of Rainworld as a whole. The story of Five Pebbles and Looks to the Moon is over. There's nothing else to get out of this. And Saint itself serves as a sort of self-sacrificial Sisyphus, repeating cycles upon cycles destined to ascend everything but itself. It makes me want more lore and clarification on how the Saint works and functions. Why is it so different from the other echoes we see in-game? If at the end of its journey it's at zero karma, why does it start again at two? Why can Saint understand language without the mark of communication? And I won't lie, me personally, I am really not a fan of super vague and cryptic storytelling. But I'm not gonna say it's bad here. I wish things were laid out a bit more clearly, but Saint, honestly, serves its purpose well enough. And again, despite the fact that I was spoiled for Saint by three different people on my own YouTube channel, I can definitely say that the Saint was my favorite new Slugcat in Downpour. Well, that was depressing, and I don't really want to end the video on a downer, so okay, I'll talk about Inv. So a little bit after the DLC was released, an ARG-type riddle was given to players to solve. The solution to this riddle was players needing to type in the word Sophanthiel onto the main menu. Doing this will unlock Inv, or ?, or Enot as it's referred to by the developers. So what makes this campaign so special? Well, without fail, every cycle starts with a shelter failure, Inv needs 12 food pips to hibernate and can store none for the next cycle, they have the same combat stats as Monk, they make silly funny noises when being hurt or killed.
Good night, gamer.
And almost every region is changed in some way. Inv also spawns with and generates a singularity bomb every cycle, which is one of the only mercies this mode gives you, and believe you me, you will need this bomb, as even if the region remains relatively unchanged, the spawns are not. Now, this campaign has no goal like the other ones. There's no food quest, no delivery, nothing you need to do but attempt to survive and eventually ascend. So I'm just gonna cover regions in an order that might make sense, but this is Inv, so who gives a shit? We start out in Memory Crypts, which is everyone's favorite fucking region. Shaded Citadel is actually mostly normal, aside from the metric fuckton of spitter spiders and red lizards that spawn. Great. Going left from Shaded and into Industria offers a relatively unchanged region. Aside from these bastards, train lizards, they were originally part of the Hurricane mod, but were ported in here because the devs hate you. They are red lizards on every stimulant drug known to man who only wish to kill. I've encountered 4, even 5 of these things in a single room, and unless you yeet that egg, you are not coming out of it alive. If you head from Industrial into Pipeyard, you'll find yourself in tubes, in which the biggest change is just a rainbow filter slapped over the foreground. God, I love gay people. There's also a small subregion here, and it's the only subregion that is exclusive to Inv, which is known as Andrew's Basement. The mural is only one room long, covered in otherwise unused graffiti of the more Slugcats team. If you keep going left from Industrial, you'll reach, "We forgot to render this one. Sorry." Yep, that sure is unrendered. No matter how well you think you know this area, you will struggle to figure out where the hell you are. Poles and other important geometry now blend completely in the background. There's about 5 million red centipedes per square inch. And this is a good time to mention that slug pups can spawn in this mode. They work normally, except they look like this. And if they die, they act like a singularity bomb. So, you know, if you're in danger. If you head into Farmeries, it's not too terribly different, but there is a lot more wormgrass. Like a lot of wormgrass. In case you wanted more wormgrass. What the hell? Some of my personal favorite changes they made are to Sky Islands. Five Pebbles has seized the area and has spewed rot all over it. There's a gravity disruptor somewhere, and because the devs don't want you to float off infinitely into the aether, if you go off screen, you will just loop back around to the other side. And if you come in from the Farmeray side, there's a bunch of those bug zapper things. Great. I know it goes without saying when playing as this character, but Chimney Canopy is weird. If you try to jump, you immediately get exhausted. The only way to circumvent this is by using a yeek. The more astute of you may note that yeeks cannot spawn in Chimney Canopy. The good news is, every time you exit a pipe, a yeek spawns. Why? So, the entirety of the exterior basically has the same theme around it. It's the exterior, but there's more rot. Renaming the leg to the Tower of Gains and the underhang to the Uberhang was very, very good though. Five Pebbles. Someone pissed in it. I want to know which dev looked at Five Pebbles and said, "Water. Let's make it a water level." The graffiti of the five natural urges right outside of Pebbles are washed out and gray for some reason. It might just be a color palette thing, but it looks weird. And not technically five pebbles, but if you go left through the Karma Gate, you get to see this graffiti, which was originally unused, but is now in the game. Great! The best part is that Five Pebbles has unique dialogue for if you visit him.
"Hello, creature. You've come at the perfect time. The solution has been found. The solution is portable. The solution has been implemented. And it comes in 3 delicious flavors. 5 Pepsi, triple affirmative. Would you like to try a sample?" And this is how you die. Get fucking dabbed on. Holy shit. I'm so fucking swag.
I want off this wild ride. On the topic of iterators, you can actually visit Looks to the Moon. Shoreline itself is relatively unchanged, except for being a bit darker and more sparky than usual. And Moon herself is, despite the fact that this campaign is non-canon, it does appear that they've given it a point in the timeline. This is very recently after Moon collapsed. If you go around the Looks to the Moon region, you'll see that a lot of her equipment is barely functioning, rather than just straight up defunct. If you go left from Shoreline, you reach Nachos Will Never Be the Same Again, replacing garbage wastes. This has the same color palette as Hell and consists of nacho cheese that kills you instantly. Yes, there are shelter failures every cycle. Yes, you can very easily get softlocked. Continuing left from garbage leads you to Painted System, which might actually be impossible. Snails manifest out of midair, and instead of popping, they explode.
You know, I don't know if I want to be here. I'll be honest.
Oh my god.
Wait, what happened?
And the last but not least is Subterranean, in which every room you enter slowly fades to become completely pitch black without a light source. Awesome. And Depths is actually completely unchanged. So, what do you think, dear viewer, is the payoff for this? After surviving eye strain, red lizard spam, deadly nacho cheese, and a rot infestation, what do you get for this? Well, I'll let this clip speak for itself.
Oh, fuck!
Oh, no!
None of you are going to heaven. The More Slugcats team created an entire dating sim for beating the meme cat. Each character has multiple endings, multiple fully drawn sprites, and some of the funniest dialogue I've ever read. The cherry on top is that in the background, a slowed down version of Kayava plays. You know, that one really funky saxophone song that plays in Sky Islands. There is nothing that I could say that can replace just witnessing this shit.
She suddenly pauses in the air with the egg.
Oh, no. Wait a second. This egg?
Yeah, it's an egg.
This egg is just the right amount of portable.
Oh, yeah, eggs tend to be that way.
This game has inserted the phrase, "This is pretty unlore, my man," into my common vernacular, and I cannot forgive it for that. Thanks, Andrew. I think that we can all agree that this really was a Rain World downpour. Even though it has flaws, some more glaring than others, it's clear that this was a project that came from the heart. Rain World has never been a conventional 2D platformer, and even the base game isn't perfect, but that's kinda what makes it special. The biggest thing for me is that this obviously wasn't done for money, it's not a cash grab. Sure, sales are an incentive, an encouraging factor, but Downpour was led by passionate fans who had already loved the game. I am stoked that VideoCult brought on modders from the community to develop this DLC, and they really did do it justice. $15 for potentially hundreds of hours of new content is borderline criminal. Is it fan servicey? Hell yes, but I am a fan, and I do feel very serviced. Not to mention that even if you're not playing one of the new campaigns, Downpour adds so much to the vanilla stories with the new areas and creatures alone. Rainworld had been stuck in development limbo since 1.5 came out on PC, due to what I understand to be IP issues with Adult Swim. As soon as they got that IP back, they got to work. I'll be honest, I wasn't even planning on picking up Downpour day one. I'd fallen so far out of the community that I stopped working with other YouTubers, participating in projects, and just didn't really care about the game anymore. I've played 400 hours in the past 3 months. And genuinely, the Rainworld community is one of the most supportive and inclusive communities I've ever been a part of. If you're not, join the Rainworld Discord server. And if you're in there but don't talk, try. Get involved, post art, make friends. It's a great place to just exist. You will meet people and talk to people that you never would have thought you would. Downpour as a whole gives so much more than it takes away. The writing is fantastic. They characterized Moon and Pebbles perfectly. A lot of the conversations feel like they could have been in base game. They're just that good. Yes, it fucks with the lore, and yes, there are some parts of it that I really, really don't like. But at the end of it, it's still just Rain World. At the end of the day, I'm still dying to a white lizard and chimney canopy if I'm playing as Saint or if I'm playing as Hunter. So, a huge thank you to VideoCult, a huge thank you to Andrew and all of the More Slugcats team. Thank you to all of the devs, the artists, everybody who even vaguely touched this project, because you did make something special. The only thing that there is to consider at this point is, where is Rainworld going now? If you haven't already been made aware, VideoCult recently increased the price of Rainworld from around, I believe, $20 to $25. And one of the reasons they listed for this was because they wanted to develop more for Rainworld. and I'm not actually sure what they would do there. Like I said, Looks to the Moon and Five Pebbles' story has pretty much already been told, and at this point, as much as I love the original world, I really don't want to go through it again. Putting a new expansion that resides in the same world is kind of redundant. If anything, I think if they're looking to still go forward with this franchise, they should take us to a new area completely, take us near No Significant Harassment, Seven Red Suns, give me Chasing Wind content even. But at that point, that would just kind of be a sequel to Rain World. So I don't really get it, but whatever they put out, I know I'm gonna enjoy, so whatever. Well, you made it. The end of the video. I did not expect it to be this long, nor did I expect it to take this long. Sorry, by the way, but I am pretty proud of the finished product, and I hope you enjoy it too. This was kind of my big magnum opus for this point in my channel, and I'm not quite sure where to go from here. I definitely think I'll be making more Rain World content, I'm just not sure what yet. Mainly, I've actually been streaming and speedrunning. I have a Twitch channel that goes by the same name, Astral Wizard, if you're at all interested in that. Same with my Twitter, I do a lot more art than I do videos. So if you just want Rain World content, that's what you're mainly going to be getting from me in those spaces. As for here, I absolutely want to do more co-op with my friends. It seems like you guys really, really like that. So I will force them to do more of that, if that so pleases you. I also beg you to forgive me for any inconsistencies and quality issues. I don't tend to do scripted content very much, much less an hour long of scripted content, so mic issues and editing issues and me being stupid, all of that is just a result of me being stupid. And honestly, even now as I am recording this conclusion, it's May 3rd and I know I need to get the video out soon, but I just can't stop thinking of things that I want to keep adding because I miss them, but I can't because I can't delay this video another goddamn month. So if I missed something incredibly important, I will probably put it into the comments. And if you have anything to comment on, things that you'd think I should have brought up, or things that you just want to bring up, the comment sections are always there. I do try to read most of my comments. I've been slacking on that recently because I've just been trying to get this done. But like I said, this is my magnum opus, my little baby boy, so I will be keeping a close eye on what people think of it. Thanks again for watching, and thanks to all of my friends that helped me out with this video. Don't worry, I will make you work with me again. Have a good rest of your time zone, and stay tuned for more bullshit.
Anyways.
Oh god, no, I'm not doing this again.